Hello there, thank you for joining us here on New Vision TV, and this is The Handshake with me, Lynn Komjisha, where we look at what's happening in our economy, in the business sector, and so very much into your financial, private business and those financial problems you get. And we try to, look at them and understand them and find a way of helping each other understand some of these things that happen around us. I have Paul Busharizi with me here. Paul, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Now, I think it's about 2 days or three, the presidents of Uganda and Tanzania flagged off the construction of the 1,445-kilometer pipeline. I got that right.
Oil pipeline.
Oil, yes. Oil pipeline. And it is from Western Uganda to Tanga Seaport. And they also got five farms, I think, a team of five farms.
Consortium.
Yeah, for the oil refinery. Mm-hmm. What is all this?
Well, of course, as everyone knows, we've been prospecting for oil in Western Uganda.
Yeah.
And actually, interestingly, 10 years ago, it was determined that there are enough quantities to make it commercially viable.
Mm.
So now we are trying to bring this oil to the ground. So you're going to extract it, and how do you get it to the markets? So
okay.
we're following two prongs. We are going to have a pipeline, mm-hmm. like the one they've commissioned,
mm-hmm.
and we're going to have a refinery which will process the crude oil into petrol and diesel and kerosene and every other thing.
And we're going to use that as a country?
It's going to be for local production, yeah.
Okay.
I think the refinery is going to initially be for 20,000 barrels of oil a day.
Oh.
And will be built up to 60,000 barrels. Because I think the demand for the East African region, the last time I saw, was about 27,000 barrels a day. That must have gone up by now, but yes. So 20,000 is enough to handle Uganda and a bit of maybe northern Tanzania, a bit of eastern Congo and southern Sudan.
Why? What should we look out for as Ugandans for this?
Several things obviously are going to happen. These investments, as you said, like the pipeline, the refinery, are really high capital intensive investments.
Yeah.
I think the pipeline is going to cost in all
14
trillion.
Yes.
14 trillion shillings, and the refinery as well about the same.
10 trillion.
10 trillion shillings. So initially this money is going to come in, not all the inputs are from locally, but you can expect some labor, some local supplies like food, some contracting jobs, some logistical jobs. So hopefully it'll get us out of our current problems. So no money.
I really hope they're going to include the youth in this, because we have a very huge unemployed youth percentage in the country. Should they look out for these things? Should they?
The issue of what they call local content has been a pressing one.
Mm-hmm.
How do we get locals to come in? Because interestingly, the skills needed on these kind of projects are highly specialized.
Okay.
We're not joking, it sounds funny, but it is actually true that even welders will need some foreign certifications, just not a matter of just...
Foreign?
Yes. Plumbers, even carpenters, everyone has to get certification. So if I was a guy looking to work in these places,
mm-hmm.
I would start looking around for where I can get some international certification.
Why should...
I think the point is, I think what happens is that these companies that do these kind of projects are so huge. And one of the things they have to do is ensure the project. Ensure the people, ensure the project. And the insurance companies are only going to ensure certain standards. So for example, if we're going to insure your trucks, your truck drivers better be internationally certified to drive those trucks. We're not just going to give some guy who bought his, bought his permit in Kampala to do this truck. In fact, talk about trucks. They told me last time we were doing the story in the newsroom that we're going to need at least 2,000 trucks.
2,000?
Each of those trucks need at least three people.
Okay.
Or with the driver, a driver, standby driver, and a third person. All of whom have to be certified
internationally.
And that if you go around Uganda, you can't even find 100 guys like that.
What?
Locals. So it just gives an impression. I mean, if you're a young person, you know, let's just say there's still, I think there's still some time.
Mm.
Go on the net, mm-hmm. surf for internationally accredited courses, mm-hmm. and find a way to do it.
You're a welder,
you're even scaffolding. Do you know these guys who build these scaffolding things? You used to think it's just like Lego.
Yeah, I know. Like I mean, you just...
No. You have to be internationally certified to scaffold. So if you're a youth thinking yes. like that, that's one thing you think about jobs. But also, you know, you need to find a way into some of these networks. For example,
True.
Even if you're going to provide food, you don't just stand up and say, I'm here with my tomatoes. You have to be in certain groups, which I think the Private Sector Foundation of Uganda is trying to get together, as well as other groups, to try and get these things together. Because the story is that between now and 2020, when the oil is supposed to start coming out,
mm-hmm.
we're going to spend at least $20 billion.
$20 billion?
$20 billion is going to be spent. Now, in the previous, in our previous exploration of oil, I think they said we spent about $1 billion or something. And only about, I think, 20% of that money was made by locals. So if you can push that percentage
higher,
it'd be good for everyone.
I'm very disappointed. We don't have those international schools, if I could call them, to have our guys here certified, because not everyone can afford an international certificate for those things.
True. I mean, the challenge is that even if you're going to do like a 1 month course,
mm-hmm.
in plumbing to get first level of certification or something, it still
yes.
costs quite a bit. I read the other day the government is trying to get some money together, I think with some donors to sponsor locals. There are some institutions around
mm-hmm.
Uganda now that are trying to upgrade their standard to be able to issue this international certification.
Mm.
But still, it's really very costly, right? So I think government is also trying to work on how to get people, how to pay or give scholarships to these people. But you know, if I was a youth, I wouldn't really wait around for the government
and
find my own ways of getting the money to pay for it and do it myself.
Because I think this is a project that is going to benefit you and I and everyone else, and we need to tap into it. Uganda, you know, we are used to boycotting certain things. So the youth out there, the thing is, get certified internationally. If you have something, please work on it. Instead of, you know, at the end of the day, government etuyambe, you have to help yourselves, and then the government will come in. Thank you, Paul, for that insight. I hope the youth have picked that, because we need to tap into this project. It is a huge one, and it's going to be on for a while. I was actually worried.
And it's going to happen with or without us.
With, exactly.
Because they can bring the people in.
But of course,
yeah.
And the country needs these things, so they're not going to wait around for you. Thank you, Paul, for that.
You're welcome.